Hi everyone, my name is Nick, and today I want to talk about plants that I no longer bother with growing in my home or purchasing anymore. All of the houseplants I'm going to talk about in today's video, I would wholeheartedly consider to be future garbage, and I would absolutely steer any new indoor gardener away from growing these houseplants because they are a total headache and a complete waste of your money. And of course, I'm going to embellish on why I believe that is. And of course, I also have to mention that this video is complete opinion based on my own experiences, so I'm sure that some of you or some of your friends might have different experiences than me, but my YouTube channel is about sharing my own gardening experiences, so that's what I'm here to do today. Because today's video is about plants that I no longer bother with, unfortunately, I don't have that many examples to hold on screen to share with you guys, so please do bear with the old Instagram photos I am probably digging up to put on screen. However, I do have a couple of examples to share. It's just that they have, quite frankly, been to hell and back, and you're gonna just see these plants for their truest colors today. So the first group of plants I wanna talk about today is a group of plants I absolutely love, which honestly, I love every single plant I'm gonna be talking about in today's video. It's just that I love them aesthetically. I hate everything else about them. Their behaviors are absolutely piss poor in the home. So that being said, the first group of plants I want to talk about today is Episcias. Episcias are commonly referred to as flame violets, and they are seriously one of the most gorgeous houseplants out there. They have some really stunning foliage that comes in practically every color of the rainbow, LOL Pride Month, and the texture of the leaves are incredible. Like, they are just so fuzzy and velvety. It's fantastic. There's a lot to love about this plant aesthetically. This is the type of plant you're going to walk into a houseplant store. You're going to see the tray of Episcias that, like I said, contains every color of the rainbow, and I can guarantee you, you're probably going to want to bring at least one or two home because you're going to need at least a couple colors of this gorgeous plant to try out. But then, unfortunately, after you bring this plant home, everything kind of goes downhill from there, at least in my own experience. I feel like Episcias are like the equivalent to that person that you meet that you're like totally enamored by, and you think they're the most beautiful person on earth until you start to get to know them and they turn out to be apocalyptic. So Episcias, you can practically look at them the wrong way and they're going to die on you. But the real stuff is that they're very finicky when it comes to temperature. It could be too hot or too cold and your Episcia is not going to be happy, specifically cold. They really can't handle cold drafts at all. I think growers have told me if it goes below 60 degrees, the Episcias are not going to be happy. And that's like, that's very needy. That's more needy than me. You also have to be really careful about getting water on the leaves of your Episcias. They're very finicky when it comes to getting cold water on the leaves. That's going to cause leaf spots. And if the leaves are wet, even with warm water, but they're sitting in the sun, the leaves are going to get damaged and they're going to look ugly. So they are just, they're very, very, very needy houseplants. I have never cared for an Episcia and had it thrive for me. I feel like they only deteriorate very quickly and practically just wilt and fall over. And most of the time, I don't even know what I did wrong, but there are just so many things that you can do wrong with your Episcias that I just don't really bother with them anymore. I do technically have one still. It's this little pink one in here. And I feel like the only reason it's alive is because it's taking care of itself inside this bottle, which I keep the top off of. But I had a couple other plants in here, like ferns that did die back. You can kind of see their carcasses, but the Episcia is the only one still going strong. I don't like saying going strong because it's obviously not thriving, but it's surviving, and that's more than any other Episcia has done for me. So I'll accept it. I'm not going to get rid of it, but I'm not expecting amazing things out of this, but maybe one day I'll have a nice bottle full of Episcia, but that seems eons away. So the next group of plants I want to talk about is very similar to Episcias in the sense that they look gorgeous, but that's really the only thing to love about them, and that's prayer plants. So prayer plant is an umbrella term for any houseplant that falls into the Marantaceae family, which includes genera such as Calathea, Maranta, Tenanthe, and Stramanthe are definitely the most prevalent ones on the market. There are some types of prayer plants, though few and far between, that I do have good experiences with. I will admit, the ones that have green on the backside of the leaves, so for example, Calathea orbifolia or Calathea mosaica, those are some types of prayer plants that I've had some good success with growing in my home, but it is definitely a short list. Typically, when you walk into a houseplant store, you're going to be greeted with a beautiful display of prayer plants that sport, once again, practically every color of the rainbow. I didn't realize I was doing this video for Pride Month, you guys, but ones like Calathea medallion, Stramanthe, Triostar, they have such beautiful colors on the fronts and the backsides of the leaves, and they are the ones that tend to be the biggest headache. So I do have an example today. I do have this Stromanthe sanguinea triostar. I think it has a different name at this point, but you know that's going to take a while to catch on. So this is arguably the most beautiful prayer plant out there. There are so many beautiful prayer plants, but this is the one for me that always catches my eye, and I'm always just like, damn, that is such a beautiful house plant. Unfortunately, its behavior is horrible. So the thing about this plant specifically, because this Stromanthe does have some gorgeous shades of white and cream on the leaves, when these plants get brown on them, it looks bad. Like, it does not look good at all. I'm very forgiving with my houseplants. I don't mind if they get like a little bit of brown or a little bit of yellow here and there, but because of these leaves being such works of art, when they just get one little bit of brown on it, like I said, I think it just looks, it looks not happy, and people very quickly probably think that their plant's dying if they're new to gardening. This specific Stromanthe is one that my friend gifted me because I was telling her that I've had very bad luck growing this plant, and she said she had been growing one for a couple of years. Like I said, everyone has different experiences. That has been thriving for her, so she was like, I'll give you a couple offshoots of that since it's been doing so well, acclimating to her conditions, that she thought it would do better in mine. And it's definitely held up better than Stromanthes I've grown in the past. I can't even count how many Stromanthes I've tried growing at this point. This is definitely the one that's held up the longest and looks the best, but it still gets those brown edges and tips. So my rule of thumb across the board when it comes to calatheas is that if the plant is getting brown on the sides of the leaves or the edges, that it is probably lacking humidity. So these plants are very needy when it comes to humidity. I would recommend using a humidifier. Typically in the summertime, the humidity is high enough. Right now in my bedroom, it is 67% humidity. I'm filming this in June, so it's basically summer. I'm not using a humidifier in my home. That would be overkill right now. So this is totally fine for these prayer plants to thrive. However, it's when the winter time comes around and we turn on the heat in our home, which dries out our air immensely, and that humidity percentage is probably going to drop to like a solid 30 or 20%. It's going to get pretty low, a little too low for prayer plants. I believe they like to be around like 40 to 60% to stay happy inside. So in winter is usually when I start to see the brown show up on my calatheas. I typically buy my prayer plants in spring or summer. I enjoy them for 6 months while they're looking gorgeous, and then in wintertime, inevitably, they usually get a little bit of brown edging, and if they're able to hang on like this one right here, I will happily hold on to them, but if they get really, really beat up and crispy, I'll usually just oust them and consider getting a new one when the springtime comes again. But at this point, I'm not really bothering with it because I just know I'm going to spend $20-$30 in a big, beautiful 6-inch pot of a prayer plant, and by wintertime, I am probably going to be getting rid of it because I have cycled through a lot of prayer plants at this point, let me tell you. My other rule of thumb, along with the brown edges, is for the brown tips. So if your prayer plants are getting brown tips, it's probably because of the type of water that you're using. Prayer plants, amongst many other types of plants, are very susceptible to some of the minerals that we have in our tap water. So there's things like chlorine, bromine, fluoride that these plants cannot transpire out of the tips of their leaves, and they kind of store minerals or contaminants, whatever you want to call it, in the tips of their leaves, and that's why they get these brown tips. So you can figure out what's going on with your prayer plant. You can kind of troubleshoot them a little bit, whether they have brown edges or tips. You can try to remedy the situation from there. Unfortunately, once the leaf is already brown, it's not going to turn back to green. So a leaf like this is something I would probably consider removing in a week or two's time if it's really starting to bother me. I tend to be very type B with my plants, but for some reason, calatheas, they get brown, they get ugly, and I just sometimes can't deal with looking at it. But I'm very forgiving with like my philodendrons if they get a little brown here or there. But these prayer plants are just so beautiful. They're works of art that just a little bit of brown on them, I just don't know how much I can deal with it anymore. Maybe I'm a little bit more type A than I think. But anyway, so let's talk about palms. So I absolutely love palms, but I do not have a single example to share with you guys in my home today because I have completely given up on them. Palms are absolutely a vibe. They are like the epitome of a tropical houseplant, and I feel like every indoor gardener at some point in their career has tried growing a palm. However, I think the most common example of people bringing palms into their homes is when new gardeners go to their big box store, their local plant store, whatever, and they find a majesty palm, which are always sold dirt cheap. And there's reasons behind that, which I will share with you guys. They bring the majesty palm home. They have this gorgeous palm that's like as tall as me, as their centerpiece in their living room or bedroom. And it probably takes a solid 2 weeks for that thing to look like crap. So majesty palms specifically are not indoor plants. They are more suitable for like your patio or your balcony. It's a plant that you spend $10 or $15 on a large plant in the springtime to put out on that balcony. And when the weather starts to cool down, you put it out for trash or you leave it out there to die or whatever you want to do. People sometimes bring them inside, but they're just going to die. They're also a plant that's sold so cheap because they are meant for like photo shoots. If people need a quick and easy palm for their photo shoot or whatever they have going on. If you want to impress your parents for the weekend, you get a majesty palm. Like, they're very short-lived houseplants, so they're not a rewarding plant to grow. I've never heard of somebody successfully growing a majesty palm indoors. People just ask me constantly, like my friends, like, I got this palm and it's starting to die, and I ask them what kind of palm it is. It's always a majesty palm. The reason I'm talking about majesty palms so much today is because I feel like it's kind of like a trap that a lot of new indoor gardeners fall into. Like I said, they walk into their big box store, they find these huge plants for dirt cheap, and they think, why isn't everybody bringing this palm home? Why doesn't everybody have this palm in their home? It's $10. And that's because they probably already have brought it home and they probably killed it already in the 2 weeks time that it takes. Are there other palms out there that are suitable for the home? There's more suitable ones. Obviously, majesty palm is the worst option, I could say. There are ones like a lady palm or a kensha palm that are a little bit more suitable. Unfortunately, they're expensive and they're slow growing, so they're still not very rewarding, and they probably still take time to acclimate to your home. I think the biggest deal with palms, though, the biggest mistake that people are making is that they don't water them enough. I think palms are like basically ferns when it comes to watering. Like, you need to just constantly drown them in order for them to stay happy. And they also require a whole lot of light. So it's something that I probably wouldn't recommend if you didn't have a like west or south facing window. But still, they are not plants that I recommend. Maybe one day I will try a much more suitable palm for indoors. They really are such a tropical vibe that it's like almost worth the effort. But after my experiences at home and caring for palms at the plant store, I don't see it happening for the foreseeable future. So the last group of plants I want to talk about today are ferns, specifically frilly fine ferns. I do grow a lot of ferns in my home, but they're all very hardy ferns. So like the blue star fern, kangaroo paw fern, Aglaomorpha, all of these types of ferns have very rhizomatous root systems and they handle drought a lot better. And the leaves themselves are just much more hardier and thicker than say like a Boston fern or a maidenhair fern. These frilly fine ferns are literally the epitome of future garbage. And I hate that because I love them so much. They are totally my aesthetic. I always talk about how I love plants that look like they're growing out of a crack in the sidewalk. And these plants fit that description to the T. They practically are growing out of cracks in the sidewalks, I'm sure, in areas of the world, but I feel like very similar to the Episcias, you can practically look at a fern and it's going to die or turn brown or crisp up or do whatever. It's just going to lose all of its leaves. It's going to shed all over the ground, and it's so annoying, specifically when you just want to love it. These plants are so needy with the water, very similar to the palms. However, you like need to water your fern every day or two. I had a maidenhair fern that I kept alive for over a year. Clap for me. That was a very good accomplishment, I will admit. The only way I was able to keep it alive was because every night I would bring a glass of water with me to bed, and in the morning I would dump whatever water's left over into that planter. And that was the only way I was ever going to consider keeping that plant alive, because I cannot water anything every day. I water all of my plants probably like once every like week and a half to 2 weeks. I'm very, very lackadaisical when it comes to caring for my plants. So unfortunately, ferns and I do not get along very well. I mean, any plant that's going to require a daily watering is not going to be on my list, but I really do wish that ferns and I had a better relationship. I mean, like, the goal for me would be, instead of having 350 plants all over my home, I had 350 ferns, and I had, like, my own little 650 square foot fern forest. Like, stop. That's, like, goals. And I would just, like, take walks around my little forest and just, like, curl up and snuggle up and just feel like I'm in the jungle. But realistically, if I had 350 ferns around my home, I would have 350 dead plants and a lot of dried up brown leaflets all over my floor, which arguably would kind of make it feel like a jungle, but it would be a waste of money. Fortunately, ferns are very inexpensive, so it wouldn't be that much of a waste of money compared to a lot of the other plants that we grow in our home, but I digress. I do want to say, too, just like a fun little fact, that I actually filmed this video. No, technically I didn't. I was going to say I filmed it already last week. I didn't post a video last week because I sat down to film this very video, and after 7.5 minutes of filming, I did not realize that I ran out of storage space on my camera and it stopped filming, and I went on to talk for another hour without filming. And I wasn't gonna film it again that week. So I'm back the following week filming this video again. Hopefully it was better. Doesn't matter because this is the only footage that I have of it. Anyway, just fun little fact also explaining why I did not post a video last Friday. But anyway, thank you guys so much for joining me today. If you don't already, follow me on Instagram at Frilly Foliage, subscribe to my channel, and I will see you guys in my next video. Have a great day.